Respected Majumdarji, distinguished guests and friends, it is my pleasure to extend this warm and hearty welcome to this webinar on Roadmap for Agriculture and Food Processing Sector of West Bengal in COVID era. Although I had quite a few points lined up for, in my opening remarks, but given that we are running a little late, I'd like to start with, first of all, specially thanking our chief guest, Sri Pradeep Kumar Majumdar, who's the chief advisor to the Honorable Chief Minister of West Bengal on agriculture and allied sectors, for agreeing to address this exclusive session and interact with us. Sir, as we all know, Bengal lives in the villages and agriculture is their mainstay. Our state is endowed with diverse natural resources and varied agroclimatic conditions and tops in paddy production and vegetables, despite the fact that our average land holding is only 0.77 hectare. To go for extensive cultivation with economies of scale, we need to consolidate on our land holding, and the FPOs are a step in that right direction. We feel that contract farming and corporatization of agriculture with retaining the land rights with farmers could be a possible solution. We would like to know your considered opinion on this point. Farm mechanization is another issue. As per the National Sample Survey reports, there is a growing aversion in the younger generation to work on farms, and they want to come out of agriculture, as agriculture is considered non-remunerative and not even glamorous. In many states such as Punjab, Haryana, production of agriculture implements and tools are encouraged, which helps in reducing the drudgery involved. A simple yet effective way to encourage local MSMEs to manufacture in Bengal for Bengal would be to allocate specific budgets for subsidy for local made products. This has actually worked quite successfully in our neighboring state of Bihar. While on paper, we have two testing centers in West Bengal. Most testing required for farm machinery is happening in other states like Assam and Odisha. We implore you to take this at the national level and get us a farm machinery training and testing institute in West Bengal. Sir, this will give a huge boost to the agrarian economy of the state. In our meeting earlier, you suggested that farmers are now advised to reorient their cultivation towards demand-driven crops, which is more market-friendly, and they will get better price for their produce. Our state produces sufficient rice, potato, vegetables, but is deficient in pulses, oilseeds, and maize. Pulses we used to call as poor man's protein, which is no longer in the reach of the poor man. Then why is that our farmer is not producing these items which have higher demand? Coming to the food processing, agro-processing sector, West Bengal is the front runner. We are among the top three states, and 30% potatoes, 27% pineapples, and the statistics can go on. But additionally, West Bengal government also has drawn up a number of policies and plans to focus on the selected areas like vegetables, fruits, and fisheries, rice, poultry, dairy, and floriculture to encourage private entrepreneurship for processing of fruits, vegetables, and horticulture items. Main processed products in the fruit and vegetables category are jams, jellies, pickles, sauces, canned sliced fruit, and squash. In this context, sir, we are eager to know, how can the state government encourage startups in the agri and food processing sector, especially during this COVID-induced downturn? There is a flourishing market for our fruits and processed fruit products, but for exports, stricter quality control measures and quality packaging are essential preconditions. To capture export markets, we would like to know what the industry can do with guidance and support from the state government to harness this potential. Before I invite Sri Suresh Agarwal, who's the chairman of the MCCI Council on Agriculture and Food Processing, to deliver his address, I would like to share my personal experience in the last few weeks about the relative resilience of rural Bengal in the COVID pandemic. While the urban juggernaut was brought to a standstill by COVID, relatively, our rural Bengal has been by and large functional and unaffected, something for all of us to ponder over. Over to you, Mr. Suresh, for your remarks.
And friends, we are extremely glad to have Sri Pradeep Kumar Majumdar this webinar on the roadmap to agriculture and food processing sector of West Bengal in the COVID era. Sri Akash Shah, Senior Vice President of our Chamber, in his welcome address, has already covered most of the agri and processing issues of the state. After 2 months lockdown due to the spread of coronavirus and the Amphan devastation, the agriculture sector of Bengal has been hit twice. I will not take much time as we are all eager to hear from Mr. Majumdar. So I'd like to hand over it to him with some few points. What kind of support can the government for organic farming be provided by the state? Apart from the financial support, what are the items of such as soil testing, water facility, availability of proper organic certification, transportation? Labor problem is also a big problem, is an issue with the agriculture these days. What support government can provide with regards to this? And sir, wherever the national highway project is going on, NHAI, they have excavated a lot of land here and there. The roads are not motorable. And due to Amphan and now in the rainy seasons, we are going to face a very huge problem of water logging into our fields. The water does not seem to go because of these nalas have been blocked by NHAI. We have written to them also, sir. Sir, we have Mr. Pradeep Kumar Majumdar as a chief guest who will share his view. Thank you, sir. It's over to you now.
Thank you. Few points that Mr. Would you like me to respond?
Yes, Dr. Majumdar, give you valued comments and guide enlighten us now, please.
How did I lose the connectivity now? Can you see me? You can hear me?
Yes, we can hear you crystal clear.
Okay, so don't really have to see me. That's not important. But, Mr. Akash had initially made certain points. I would first respond to that. The contract farming, you rightly mentioned that we should look at the West Bengal model. We have been very, very serious about not tinkering with the rights to property, because that's a very, very sensitive issue. And therefore, retaining the land, farmland with the farmers or the farmland owners, we have encouraged entrepreneurs to come and get a kind of a contract with group of farmers. It could be a PO, it could be a registered society, so that you have a contract with the farmer groups instead of individual farmer, and there the government would be a facilitator. This had been approved by our cabinet some 3 years ago, and we are still encouraging. A lot of companies have shown interest. Some of them have already started working with such groups and making good headway, including production of standardized fruits and vegetables, and also packing, they're exporting it into a very, very high-end economy. So that's already functional. So those who are interested to get more details, they may get in touch with our food processing industry and horticulture department in Benfish Bhavan, next to our health department's state level office in Sotia. The other aspect which was very relevant raised was about the kind of disenchantment, should I say, of the rural youth to get involved or sustain their vocation in agriculture. They would rather like to shift to some other vocation because of A, it's not lucrative, B, it's not very, it's neither very glamorous, and they want to stay away from the drudgery. Oh my God. Are you able to hear me? something yes. wrong?
Yeah, no, we can hear you. We can hear you.
Okay. So forget about the video. You see, you listen to me, whatever.
So even your video is very clearly visible to us.
Oh, I see. I see a different screen in front of me. I am not able to see you. That's very unfortunate. But anyway, you know, let me tell you that, yes, it's been very, very unremunerative. And therefore, this government, right from the beginning, had been focusing on agricultural development with an objective of only increasing per capita income in agricultural activities. We have been, the key to that, as you had mentioned already, is only by ensuring producing what is in demand. Now, traditional knowledge prompts them to go in for Kharif paddy cultivation, which we call Aman paddy primarily. The couple of weeks ahead of Aman comes Aus, but Aus has lost its glamour and its relevance. It's primarily Aman paddy that is grown throughout West Bengal. That's a traditional crop for us. And for generations, our farming community had been growing it. But we had introduced post 50s a new crop in the season of what we call boro paddy here in the Rabi season. That is, being a comparatively new crop, it is easier to shift them from such boro paddy to crops which are more remunerative. And it's a good point that you made, but you probably don't know that West Bengal since 2011 had already grown in oil seeds by more than 2 points. And even for fisheries, where we have a lot of focus. Therefore, it's grown by more than 5 times. Now, all this has helped them to get better prices, better realization, and at the end of the day, better average income for the farm families in West Bengal. There's one, of course, underlying question that why we being deficit, not only the state, the whole country is deficit in oil seeds and pulses. Pulse, we are now catching up very rapidly, but we are still net importers. Now, yet, why there is no sort of a landslide shift to oil seed and pulses? This is primarily because our weather conditions are not that conducive for growing oil seeds and pulses. Traditionally, we had not been growing these crops. Now, taking advantage of scientific developments, we are still able to improve the productivity and make it little more attractive than it used to be a decade ago. So there is a lot more focus on shifting to such crops like even pulses, various types, varieties of pulses, and also various types of oil seeds. So that is already on our agenda to make it less, labor intensive. West Bengal government had been very, very concertedly trying to encourage mechanization. Now, mechanization, we taking into account that our farmers have small holding sizes, you have already mentioned 0.7 hectare per head on an average, but it will be even smaller actually now that the state government has made the mutation free for agricultural land and completely waiving the you know, the dues and the tax for arable land in West Bengal, there is quite a spurt in getting land transferred and mutated amongst the family members. So the average holding size will further go down. Now, in a situation like this, it becomes very difficult, and people earlier used to believe that if your land holding is so small and scattered, you would not be able to really deploy large machineries which can improve the efficiency of farming and make it less labor intensive, more efficient, and more economical. Now, that has been proved wrong. Our farmers, they in group, today use larger machines. West Bengal already have more than 3,500 combined harvesters, and we induct many more from other states at the time of our harvest, which lie idle in some other states because they have earlier harvesting seasons. Therefore, the mechanization, even in such small holding, is finding its place for economic reasons, and Government of West Bengal encourages such mechanization. We encourage the rural youths to take up this as a commercial venture of buying large machines with government subsidy to the extent of 40% of the cost, and then let them out to the farmers as and when they require it. We have also, from the government, we have set up a training center, a workshop, which is first of its kind in India, where our rural youth, with priority to those who are running these kind of custom hiring centers with government subsidy, to enroll themselves, get trained on operation and also maintenance of the latest large farm machineries. The issue of testing and certifying the machines so that more manufacturers could come in, actually the accredited testing facilities are mostly under the aegis of Government of India. The one which is recognized pan-India is in Madhya Pradesh. We have, once our workshop starts functioning, we will try to set up with Government of India's testing centers accreditation, a test center in West Bengal also, if there are sufficient entrepreneurs who are interested to make these kind of large machines in West Bengal. Now, that's our approach to making agriculture more economical, more tech savvy, and also rid our farming community of the drudgery that you rightly mentioned. Now, you have also raised the issue of, did you talk about dairy and any other sector? Did you mention the subsector of dairy and meat processing?
No, I don't think I mentioned, but we would love to hear about thoughts on that.
Did I miss out on any point that you had raised? Kindly feel free to...
Something about how food processing can be further augmented and how startups could take this opportunity, given that people are focusing a lot more on organic. So that's something that...
Actually, I'm not very sure that people are focusing on organic. Is it driven by a demand, or is it driven by kind of a fashion? I would only request for startups particularly that you kindly first ascertain the demand and then take a plunge. It is good to hear. It's a good point to make that, organic has its own value. Now, organic costs more, and the market, I'm not very sure, is very, very receptive in terms of bearing a higher cost just because somebody claims that his vegetable or his produce is made out of organic production. So kindly first assess the demand and then take a plunge if you are going to only have processing of organically produced agricultural produce. Because I'm not very sure, because all that we hear about a small state like Sikkim or Himachal Pradesh, A, their terrains are different, their climatic conditions are different. And let me tell you, even a state like Sikkim, which has more than 10 lakh, under 10 lakh population, is dependent on their food grain supply from other states. So we cannot be only producing organic fruits and vegetables and then inducting our food requirement from other states. It is just not possible. It will not be economically feasible. So kindly look at the demand, and if there are concrete proposals, tell us what kind of support you are looking for. We need a short market. We need a short market for the organic produce. Organic certification is done by, it's a concept introduced by United States, which in their specification, you can see, check in on the internet, they allow use of 32 chemicals. But it's a very expensive process. In West Bengal, there are tea gardens in Darjeeling who have high value exportable tea, who get them certified. That's an internationally accredited certification system which acknowledges and which recognizes the certificate across the global markets. Any state government which claims to certify, unless they have proper certification evaluation system, it may turn out to be self-defeating. Now, these kind of state governments certification is not recognized in the international market. So you kindly ask your members to ascertain the demand and come back to us with concrete proposal of what you are looking from the government. We encourage the farming community to go for organic production only once they are assured of the organic produce market, which bears the cost of cultivation and gives them sufficient return, which they otherwise would have earned. So our mind is very clear. If there is a demand, we will give sufficient encouragement and support in terms of growing organic vegetables, organic fruits, and even if required, organic cereals. Please excuse me. Can I come back to you? Hello. Sorry for that. Hello. Can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you.
Yeah. Yeah. So that's where we are on organic. You have to come back to us saying in which area you are looking for support, and you have to convince us that you are confident about the demand for which you are going to process, and for which you are going to guarantee buyback from the farmers. And we'll encourage you to get into some kind of an agreement with the group of farming community in the area that you select for your purpose. We have done it in many cases, like the tissue culture banana There are a number of companies who are growing it, even in non-conventional areas, and we have encouraged the farmers to get into an agreement such in the growers.
Definitely.
There is, in my opinion, there is a huge opportunity to go in for supply chain business. You know, there could be huge opportunity of setting up agri supply chain business. India as a whole and West Bengal too has a diversified crop base with production of different crops, fragmented across geographies, with production of, you know, these are, you know, consumed all over India. Harvest of these crops happens in over a limited period, but their arrivals occur over 2-3 months, and their consumption could happen over the year. Such crops have to be physically moved from limited area of production to across the country. These have to be stored from harvest, even on arrival, to ensure steady supply over the consumption period. As you would make out, you know, potato here is harvested in the month of March, April, and we are still having potato and will continue to have till the fresh production comes in sometime earliest in January, February. It's all from stored products which requires artificial environment for storage. Therefore, there is a tremendous opportunity in managing the supply chain crops, and there is no single company in India that covers various categories of crops: grain, oil seeds, plantation crops, spices, fruits and vegetables. All this can be addressed by an entrepreneur or a group of companies who can really look at this opportunity very seriously. West Bengal has a huge cattle population, and you know, I was mentioning because I was encouraged to see that only yesterday we have seen in the media, Devi, yesterday the central cabinet has decided to park 15,000 crores to give a very easy credit and with subvention in the dairy and meat processing sector. And you know, crucially, and the gradual but steady trade up from fresh to processed milk in rural areas is set to continue to drive sales growth. We find that gradually people are getting into processed milk. It's becoming more popular. As urban working households become more aware of the available product options in processed dairy, the category is expected to see increased corporate activities. And that could be an opportunity for you. Growing economy and health consciousness have been driving a protein revolution, fueling demand for livestock too, poultry and fish worldwide. These will be the biggest players within the world's food economy in the next decade. Most of this growth will be met by developing economies. Poultry and egg demand will grow by over 60% and ruminant meat by 40% during this period. These are not my assumptions. These are, you know, FAO's estimates and their forecast. Animal products have thus emerged as an important segment of our domestic and external trade. West Bengal, as I said, has a huge cattle population, buffalo, sheep, goat. Numbers are there, but I don't want to load you with all this. These are variable source of meat. Growing potential of the meat industry provides huge potential for meat processing. Slaughterhouse wastes could be converted in value-added products. These are opportunities. And if really 15,000 crores are on the table for entrepreneurs to come and ask for it, and it's going to be easily available at a subvented rate of low interest plus the subvention, it's going to be a real attractive proposition. The demand for our buffalo meat had been steadily increasing in the Southeast Asian United Emirates. Hence, the location advantage of West Bengal should offer greater opportunity for setting up modern meat processing in India. Poultry is another segment which is going to be supported by this new fund that has been offered. The potential in this sector is fueled by growth in per capita income. Modern integrated poultry processing plant capable of producing breast chicken, its cut parts and other chicken products, as also egg powders and frozen egg yolk for exports, could really endow it with a lot of demands. As you know, West Bengal, if I don't talk about the fish sector, I'll not be doing justice to any potential entrepreneur looking for business opportunities. It plays a very, very important role in our economy, provides employment to lakhs of people and critical item in the menu, if not food security to population in this part of the country. Fish sector has been catering to consumers market with freshly harvested and preserved marine products. These invariably contribute to huge amounts of waste products in a scattered way, because in small markets, they keep on dressing manually this huge quantity of fish every day, whereas fish processing leads to transformation of even waste products, byproducts into commercially economic possibilities and potential environmental benefits. These byproducts can be sold as human food, but with, of course, proper certification. This could be fish meal, fish protein concentrates, fish oil, as also bioactive compounds like omega-3 fatty acids. The potentials of fish processing have largely remained unexploited as daily market requirement is high and growing. This certainly is a segment which will offer you very, very attractive opportunities, because our shrimps and our marine products are gaining in popularity in high-end economies. The United States last year had imported 40% of their marine products and mostly Vietnamese shrimps from India, having been the largest supplier of the product to the United States. And West Bengal is at an advantage with the longest seashore with conducive conditions. West Bengal government is setting up a captive breeding center for Vietnamese broods and also a world-class diagnostic laboratory, which will help us to access American market with confidence. And these will be more to service those who would be into processing and exporting the marine products. So it's going to be quite challenging. As you yourself pointed out, agriculture had been more insulated from the onslaught of COVID, not so much from the wrath nature in the form of Amphan, but the government of West Bengal had immediately stood by the farmers, as they always do, to get over the problems associated with COVID. The government, as I had mentioned, we had stepped up for quite a few years mechanization on a heavier scale. We ensured that these machineries be made available to the farming community, because our boro paddy was due for harvest, and it was quite heartening. And you'll be happy to know that 85% of our boro was harvested even before 19th of May, when we were struck by the worst cyclone ever in my lifetime. And that has been possible because of the concerted effort by the farming community and putting in service most of the large machineries that we have been able to, the base we could create over the last 4-5 years through custom hiring centers, government aid, service for the rural youth who have taken these as a commercial venture. They have been of great help. These machines work day and night, and they have been a great support, and it showed the resilience of our farming system in West Bengal to a large extent. We had kept the transportation and also transportation of inputs as well as produce, agricultural produce, exempted from any kind of effect of the lockdown. We have also supported by ensuring that transportation to the markets, wherever there was a request, we had created an app and we have responded by supplying them, making vehicles, placing vehicles both at the market and at the for the traders. We have also supported immediately after the Amphan had struck our farming community and farmland. In 9 districts, we have given them initial support for going ahead with the next crop. In areas which have been affected by very extreme salinity because of intrusion by saline water, we are giving them salt tolerant seeds of crops, which we have been researching following the ILA experience, and we have been successful in creating number of varieties which are more tolerant to saline situation than the traditional crops. We are giving those kind of seeds absolutely free of cost, along with the inputs required for restoring such soils. Apart from providing hand-holding training to farmers of such areas, plus we have also provided immediate monetary relief to farmers affected in these 9 districts. As you know, West Bengal is the only state and probably the only area in whole world where farmers are provided with free insurance cover. They can take insurance for their crop just by submitting an application. And since 2019, the state government is bearing the entire cost, and it's on state government's own portal that we accept the application, and the insurance agency is paid and employed exclusively by the agricultural department of government of West Bengal. It's totally funded, 100% funded by the state government. And we had 46 lakhs farmers enrolled for the last cropping season. We are driving hard to ensure that we reach almost 100% in Kharif. At the backdrop of this Amphan disaster, we are very hopeful that we'll be coming very close to 100%, if not 100% inside. So these are the support that we will provide, and certainly this will help our farming community to not only get over the COVID and lockdown, COVID-related lockdown situation, but also Amphan affected districts, farmers of these districts, they will also come out of all the impact of the disaster they had suffered. And we are hopeful that agricultural economy will continue to grow in West Bengal. And with the, as I started off by saying, it will continue to help them to become.
Great.
I'll invite questions from you because it's very important that our young entrepreneurs take advantage of this huge economy that we have, because agriculture has to prosper. The processing industry can trigger more growth and better economy for the agricultural sector. West Bengal being the highest producer of vegetables, as you know, that there was some neck-to-neck competition over the past few years. We claimed that we were growing more. But anyway, Government of India has found in their wisdom that West Bengal by far is the highest producer of vegetables. And today, compared to a decade ago, we are more focused on the market. Our vegetables fetch better price. And once the farmers realize that growing this kind of and this variety of vegetable is going to bring them more income, they will be standardizing on those vegetables. Therefore, it's time for processors to get into the act, because farmers are more sensitized. They are in favor of doing something which is of common standard and which will have ready market for them. So, over to you.
And sure.
You are, I'll be very happy to.
Sure. Thank you, Sri Mazumdar. You know, there are a lot of people who want to ask questions. And I would like to start by requesting Mr. Ravi Todi, who's also a you know, past president of Merchant Chamber of Commerce, to go ahead and ask the first question, please.
Namaskar, Mr. Mazumdar. Thank you very much for agreeing to address us. First of all, I'd like to congratulate you as the, under your guidance, the entire agriculture ecosystem has performed exceptionally well in the state, and all the stakeholders have prospered significantly, especially the farmer community. There has been a continuous improvement in subsidy guidelines over the years. Its process, disbursement, etc., the time of release of guidelines itself, there has been a very, very marked improvement. And West Bengal Agri Department has done a great job this year also during the COVID times. It has released the guidelines well around the monsoon time, which is a peak season for large numbers of consumption of farm input. So I would like to congratulate you and your team for this stupendous effort, sir. So just a few suggestions which we wanted to bring to your notice, sir. We have an online portal called Mati Kartha, where farmers in West Bengal need to log in for applying subsidy funds. This was an initiative taken in the right direction by your ministry and the government. But we were suggesting if it further be further information like funds allocated district-wise, block-wise, if it can be put on the thing, district-wise information of different machinery, if it is available on real-time basis, and it will really help us understand the potential of each district for these farm mechanization.
Because you may have voice is not very clear.
Sorry, sir.
I'm more interested to know what you want, and your suggestion is more important. Because yeah, compliments can wait. If you, I don't decry that. I'm very happy that you have been very kind to congratulate on my extremely hardworking, and at odd times, even on 20th, they were all whole night on the you know, in the field with the farmers facing the wrath of the nature. But yeah, now what is important in this kind of meeting is for me to understand what you want and what we can do to make sure we are able to understand.
Okay, sir. So coming to the point, what you have told me, we are suggesting in the online, you have launched
online.
For the availability of subsidy funds.
Okay.
If further elaborated the information in that regarding funds allocated district wise, and so that we can know availability of funds online also, and also different machinery on real time basis, ওখানে কি পোটেনশিয়াল আছে, ওখানে কি চলে, সো দ্যাট ভেরিয়াস ম্যানুফ্যাকচারার্স.
লেট মি ইফ আই মে ইন্টারাপ্ট ইউ.
ইয়েস স্যার.
You see, what is the potential of a particular machine is better understood by the manufacturers, isn't it? Is the government going to say that these many machines you can deploy or you can sell in that market? Would the manufacturers not be interested? You know, I have a history. 35 years I worked in a manufacturing industry in a multinational organization at the global level.
True, sir.
I never heard none of the governments, it was a global company, none of the countries had ever told us this is our potential. We had to work out our own potential and then we had to plan for creating demand for at least meeting certain percentages of this demand, depending on the sort of market share we enjoyed in those markets for our similar products or other products, we had, fixed our aspirations accordingly. So it is, I don't think it is possible, it is at all reasonable to expect that the government is going to tell you what is going to be the potential of each machine in each district. Now, you have made a point that the government could otherwise make it known that what could be the fund allocated account subsidy in each district for a particular machinery. Why we don't do it? Because this is fluid for two reasons. One is there are certain machineries which are not very supported by the farming community in certain districts. So the allocation gets, divided to amongst the districts where such machines are more popular. So instead of allowing it to lapse, we would rather transfer the funds to the areas where farmers are more keen to have those kind of machines. That is one aspect. The other thing is, depending on the demand and the need and our ability to, in a competing sort of fund allocation system, if we are able to get some little more fund out of some other departments who are not immediately requiring such allocated fund to them, then we supplement it. So we generally, we have the figures, but we don't think it should be it will have much relevance in the public domain. Because depending on the farmer's request, we see whether if say 80% of the farmer's request for that kind of machinery, the subsidy amount allocated is enough, the balance 20% we try to get from districts where it is surplus. If that is not possible, then we look at our kitty and see if from the government kitty we can get some fund from some savings by some departments and then transfer it. So that's how it works. But if there is a way we can help you to understand your requirements better, or you realizing better in a better way the opportunity is there, we try to accommodate.
May I now ask?
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Majumdar sir, and all the participants. Majumdar sir has focused on oilseed cultivation, plantation, and processing. Since our country is lacking in oilseed production, almost 70-75% of our consumptions are imported from abroad, especially palm oil. I wish to know, is there any scheme under government of West Bengal for oil palm cultivation under contract farming? Because oil palm cultivation can only be possible through contract farming. It is very well successful in Andhra Pradesh, in both Telangana and Andhra Pradesh, some part of Tamil Nadu. We as a Imami are seriously thinking about oil palm cultivation. Moreover, today I have attended SEA, this is Association for Oil Palm Cultivation, a webinar, wherein cultivation of another oil palm seed, that is mustard, is also well explained, and it is said that it is also a very prospective crop. As far as West Bengal is concerned, West Bengal is one of the biggest consumer of oil palm, I mean, sorry, mustard oil consumption. So we wish to know about the government scheme or any support for cultivation of oil palm as well as for cultivation of mustard seeds under contract farming. Thank you.
See, as I told you, contract farming is a thing where we don't encourage contract with individual farmers. And it's very difficult to enforce also. I've seen in states like Andhra Pradesh and Karnataka, where contract seed multiplication is in vogue in very large areas. But whenever there are some pilferage of research varieties of seeds, no company has so far gone to the court to settle any breach of agreement issue. Primarily because farmers in general will grow hostile to that company, they will not touch their product anymore. But if it is with a group of farmers, then it's easier to do. Now it's for you to show that oil palm is going to be more lucrative. Contract farming means what? He will grow, he will produce, you will collect the production and pay for it. So has anyone done that? We had tried it in North Bengal. There are lots of areas you can try it. You can go to the tea gardens. The tea fallow areas can be used for oil palm cultivation. But the productivity, the rate of production and the cost, it has a high gestation period. It will not be very, very easy for any individual farmer or a group of farmers to absorb that kind of revenue. There'll be no revenue for 4-5 years. Earliest you can get some peaks in 3 years. So if you have tested, shown to the farming community, the farmers who are not able to get sufficient return on what they are doing now, they will switch. So, but you tell us where you need support, we will try to tailor it in, because our efforts, you have mentioned about Telangana and Andhra Pradesh, what is the total quantity of oil palm we grow and what is the quantum of oil palm that we import? It's not even 0.05%. So just because it sounds good, we cannot ask the farmers to grow something which is not going to be paying in this kind of conditions. So if you think that you have a variety, you can grow it, which will be more profitable, we would certainly propagate that, try to work with the farmers. If they find it economically interesting for them, certainly they'll go in for it. We will encourage them to have a tie-up with Imami. We have no problem with that. But to encourage farmers to grow something for which the production and then the the realization they will have, well, that will match their current level of earning at least, if not, even if they can't exceed it, it will not be on government's work plan.
May I ask? Hello?
Yes.
Yeah, so may I ask Mr. Prateek Tulsiyan to ask his question now?
Hi. Hello.
Hello.
Yeah, am I audible?
Yes, you are audible.
Yeah, sir, I have a certain portion of land near Rajarhat. So I just want to know, like, as you were saying, for the demand of the crops, I need to know right now, what is the actual demand that the West Bengal has for the crops? Which kind of crops?
Well, you have heard we are deficit in oil seeds. We are deficit in pulses.
Yes, sir.
We had a demand supply gap in maize till last year. So you can think of growing them.
Okay. And sir, what is the scope of lemongrass, sir, in West Bengal, sir?
Lemongrass, you see, extraction of lemongrass could be used for pharmaceutical purposes. It could be used as, and it's an aromatic grass. It's also edible. As you know, some of the Thai preparations, which are very popular, we use lemongrass because of its aroma, yes, and taste. So,
yes, sir.
The demand, these are exotic plants. The demand of lemongrass is grown, it grows profusely in Northeast. It's not cultivated in an organized manner. But in West Bengal, if you are sure of getting some demand, steady demand from a pharmaceutical manufacturing company or some aromatic, produce, you can think of doing it. Your area being very close to the city markets, you can think of growing a lot of exotic vegetables. If it is, you can go in for high-tech agriculture. Greenhouses and shed nets, you can grow today. Colored capsicums, they are being sold at about 200 rupees a kilo, and there is a market, but niche market. It's not which is going to be sold like ordinary capsicum in that kind of tonnage. So it's a question of finding out before you take the plunge, please find out what could be the potential, what's the demand. And then go in for its production. You have the advantage of having your own land very close to the city, if not within the almost city limits. You grow something through high-tech agriculture, it will be more painful.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Can I ask Mr. Shekhar Agarwal to ask his question now? Mr. Shekhar Agarwal, are you there? I can see you on the screen.
Yeah, I'm there. Good afternoon, Dr. Mazumdar. Basically, in case we could encourage large manufacturers of agricultural machinery to put up their facilities and manufacturing units here, and we could also, like, we also manufacture agricultural machinery. And specifically for those machines which are relevant to West Bengal, it's like we understand that there are around 3,500 combined harvesters in Bengal. And probably none of these combined harvesters, mechanical harvesters, are manufactured in Bengal. So if you could have some sort of a manufacturing facility or a hub, or if land could be allocated, so that in case we encourage agricultural machinery to be manufactured here, which is specifically suited for our local conditions, and our farmers could then therefore benefit.
We will not put any condition that it has to be relevant to only West Bengal situation. You can manufacture
it. True, sir.
We will definitely give you land on lease, and you have to choose the area. You are most welcome. Government will provide you with land and whatever other infrastructural facility you want. There are lots of industrial hubs where ready land is available. We have offered to Mahindra and Mahindra. They wanted it in Kharagpur. There are many other companies I'll not name who have been offered land. Because of the lockdown, some progress has been slowed down or stalled, but I hope they will come back. So probably the industry association will tell you, those who keep figures. That West Bengal has the fastest growth in agri machines. And that's very understandable. Now, it may be more commercially prudent to site your manufacturing units in West Bengal. Like M&M, I mentioned, they're initially setting up an assembly line, large assembly line in Kharagpur. That's their plan. Now, of course, it's been stalled for the timing because of the lockdown. So if you have any concrete proposal, you're most welcome. Our industry department will be happy to let you know the choice of lands that you can have. You know, our hubs have already semi-developed infrastructure. So you're most welcome.
Okay. Can I have Ms. Lopamudra Mukherjee asking a question now?
Thank you, sir.
Good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon.
I want to ask you about tissue culture banana production. And actually, the cost of production is much more higher than the price of a banana sapling. So in that case, what kind of support we can get from you, sir?
The price of banana sapling to a banana are not comparable with costs. But, you know, there are companies who are doing tissue culture banana.
Yes, sir. We are from Krishi Rasayan, and we are doing this tissue culture banana in Kolnagar, basically.
In Kolnagar?
Yeah, sir.
So what kind of support are you looking for?
Your advice that the cost of production is that much high. So what can I do in that purpose to solve this problem?
I would request you to get in touch with outside this meeting. You contact me or ask Mr. Churiwal to get in touch with me. I'll tell him whom to contact, who are very successfully running this business. Their people who are look after the plantation, they can give you some good piece of advice. But if you have any specific request for support, like for sapling in certain circumstances, there is a subsidy which is given under a scheme. We can share that with you. But generally, you know, this is a good, successful business model, which is being implemented by a number of companies today. And if I can name one, Caventus is not only selling it in the local market, they're also into exports on huge quantities.
Yes, sir. Thank you so much, sir.
Welcome.
Thank you
so much.
Okay. I guess this is, I don't think we have any more questions because I tried to go through the chat. If I have left out anybody, you could please unmute yourself and ask a question to Sri Mazumdar right now.
Hello, sir.
Yes,
yeah, please introduce yourself.
Yeah, myself, Shubhankar Shaha from Krishna Exports. We are into exports of agro products. Basically, export rice, spices, and mustard oil cakes. And our major market is Bangladesh. So it was interesting you were telling us about the contract manufacturing and then getting lands and all. So this was a good knowledge. So can you help us with, suppose we want to, because we are expertised in agro exports and we have buyers for the agro products from West Bengal, which product should we focus on make a contract farming, so that we can, which will be helpful for the state as well as for our growth. Example of three products.
Okay. No, three products. I'll touch on the product which is most common in West Bengal. Okay. And you said your first produce that you mentioned as your exportable commodity happens to be rice. Now, West Bengal is the highest producer of rice in India. And we have, because our focus was on the income of farmers, we had chosen certain varieties which could fetch better realization than whole grain rice. And we have expanded gradually the khash rice area, which is better known in the urban areas as Govindohoe. And the rice which is used in Bangladesh for their biryani. Now, if you do contract farming or if you have a tie-up with SCO, the advantage you can have, we are trying scientifically to purify this particular variety so that we get the, not only sustain, we get, try to retrieve the characteristic of this particular variety. When this variety became very popular way back in 1980s in South India, the demand was surpassing the production and stroke supply. As a result, some you know, quick fix scientist breeder had given them a variety called N21. That had no aroma but had physical appearance which was similar to that of Govindohoe rice. As a result, this being cross-pollinated OP varieties, it lost its characteristics to a large extent and then it spread. So we are trying to purify, we are trying to encourage some specific FCOs to take the purified seed from our government research institutes and exclusively grow such you know, Govindohoe rice with such seeds, so that what ultimately comes out of it is pure variety of Govindohoe. So there, if you have a good market equity and in certain countries, it will be more beneficial for you to go in for a long-term arrangement with an FCO, be it contract farming or otherwise. That's for you and the FCO to decide. It may be very beneficial because you can then distinguish yourself by supplying your Govindohoe with its original characteristics, where the government is going to help without any cost in purifying the variety so that this is sustained, this characteristic of the pricey and prized position of the farming community to be continue to put them in earning more. And your business may be sustained, if not be flourishing in those countries. Now you have mentioned about oil seeds, isn't it? Is that all?
Oil cakes, mustard seed oil cakes, yes.
Right. Oh, you know, oil cakes, you have to continue to draw from the oil expellers or the crushers.
Yes.
Oil cakes are not produced by the farmer. But if edible oil export is on your agenda, then of course, being the largest producer of rice, we also encourage people to grow, to extract solvents and extract rice bran oil, which is the only edible oil which is imported by Japan also from India. It's the reverse. Okay. And West Bengal has plenty of raw material for it. Bangladesh is still selling their bran to West Bengal mills for converting it to rice bran oil. So that could be one interesting area for you. What's the other produce that you export?
We export spices also.
Spices. We are not very rich in spice. But spices, as you know, there are some states which are much bigger. But if there are any spice of interest which we grow in West Bengal, you can tell us. In hill areas, we have certain spices. We have a very expensive oil, that is linseed oil, which you grow. A lot of exporters take advantage of that. But spice, unless you have anything specific in your mind, I'll not be able to give you any lead on that.
Basically, red chilies and turmeric.
We have very good varieties, research variety which has come out in for North Bengal, for turmeric. Red chilies, as you know, nobody can probably in India beat Telangana and Andhra Pradesh.
No, but for your knowledge.
We can, great. So now I would now like Mr. Suresh Agarwal to propose a vote of thanks.
After a very engaging session on the roadmap of agriculture and food processing sector of all in COVID area, I take this opportunity to wholeheartedly thank our chief guest, Sri Pradeep Kumar Majumdar, Chief Advisor to the Honorable Chief Minister of West Bengal on agriculture and allied sectors, for gracing the webinar and enriching us through his valuable views and insight. I express my heartfelt thanks to the members of our chamber, friends, business associates, friends from the media, and all the participants for the august presence on the webinar. I believe these initiatives like these can take solutions to many problems which agriculture and food processing sector of West Bengal is facing during the COVID pandemic. I propose a hearty vote of thanks and request all of you to carry out this acclamation. Thanking you. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you. Thank you. I would like to thank MCC and its vice chair and you for taking the trouble of organizing this. I hope the participants have found some benefit out of this interaction, but any questions which you feel that could be answered in more details. At times the audio was not all that smooth, so I would request MCC to collect such questions and send it across to me. I will try to respond to them through MCC. Thank you very much. I hope.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
Encourage you to come and start your business or expand your business in West Bengal. The government is not only the farmers, would also like to be by you to ultimately help the farmers to trigger growth in agriculture sector. Thank you so very much.
Bye. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thanks.